We're in Luke chapter 12. We're going to be picking it up in verse 22 today. Last week we read as Jesus was addressing the desire for riches. We read the parable of the rich fool who had grown this great harvest, and he was planning on tearing down his barns so that he can build new barns. And then he was thinking, man, I am in good shape for retirement. I've got everything I need. My 401k is good. My barns are full. I'm doing good. And the Lord said, you fool. He said, don't you know that your life is going to be required of you tonight? And, and sometimes we really need to think in that perspective that, you know, well, we don't know how long our days are here on this earth. And, you know, we can be here one day, gone the next. You know, and there's plenty of scripture that tells us that as we dedicate our lives to the Lord, as we live our lives for the Lord, our life is extended. Well, why would God extend our lives, if we're living them for? Because he wants the world to see his goodness, his grace, his mercy. He wants the world to get a glimpse of who he is. And as we live that way, as we demonstrate the love of Christ through our own lives, the world gets to see that. And so he wants the world to see the goodness, the love, the mercy, the grace. You know, when you look at my life, and you look back at my previous life when I was young and stupid, and I know some of you are thinking, oh, that was last week, wasn't it? No, I'm talking about when I was young and stupid, and I look back at that and I say, wow, I've come along. Many of you don't know me. All of you don't know me from when I was young, and I made plenty of mistakes. But there are people that know me from that. My own family knows me from when I was a teenager and growing up, and then when I became a Christian, and my whole life changed. And, you know, many people know me from when I became a Christian and my life changed and I wasn't doing very good at it. And it took years to see what God was doing in my life. The same for many of you. And as we mature in Christ, as we grow closer in our walk with him, as we become more aware and knowledgeable of his word, we become more effective instruments for him to reach the world. Remember, it's him reaching the world, not us, but him. He's going to use us, but he reaches the world through our lives if we allow him to. Today's message is don't worry, be ready, as we continue our study through the gospel of Jesus Christ with Luke chapter 12 and verse 22, where we read, then he said to his disciples, therefore I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, nor about the body, what you will put on. Life is more than food, and the body is more than clothing. Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which have neither storehouse nor barn, and God feeds them. How much more value are you than the birds? And which of you, by worrying, can add one cubit to his stature? If you then are not able to do the least, why are you anxious for the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. And yet I say to you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. If then God so clothes the grass, which today is in the field and tomorrow is thrown in the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? And so here he is, addressing his disciples, we're told. This isn't for the multitudes. The multitudes were there too. They were listening to this teaching by Jesus, teaching his disciples, and they could hear what he was explaining to them. And that should also encourage them and entice them to know more, to draw close to him, to hear what he has to say, to follow what he has to say. The difference between the multitude and the disciples are the disciples recognized him as the master, the teacher, their leader, the one that is instructing them. And quite often, there are people that recognize Jesus as being in the Bible, that he was a person that lived on earth, but they don't recognize him as Lord and Savior. They don't recognize him as the Son of God. They recognize him as a historic figure. They can read his writings and they can say, oh, wow, I'm encouraged by that. Oh, that really speaks to me. And Jesus spoke to many people, and a lot of his teachings are encouraging, even to people that don't believe in him as Lord and Savior. But then when you get to those parts where it can be a little convicting, it can really cut to the heart, that's when they're like, oh, well, I'm not going to take it that far. You know, I'm not going there. Well, if he was a good teacher, then you have to take everything that he taught and receive it all. Because a good teacher isn't going to teach something bad one day and something good the next. A good teacher is going to teach good all the time. And Jesus did. Because he's not only a good teacher, he's the God teacher. He's God teaching us what we need to know. And so when we hear these teachings, it's not just, wow, that was nice for them back then, but we don't live in those day and ages anymore. This is all different. We have a different set of rules. You know, we've evolved. I don't want to evolve. I don't want to become different because God made me the same way that he made everyone else over the course of the centuries. We're all human, and we all, oh yeah, sure, we have different homes. We have air conditioning. Praise God. You know, he's blessed us with awesome things living in this day and age. But he remains the same yesterday, today, and forever. Truth is always true. Truth isn't true yesterday and today is false. Okay? Truth is always going to be true. And so when we read the Word of God, he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me, speaking of himself. And so we should know that we are listening and learning and hearing from the truth when we read teachings like this. He says, hey, consider the birds, the ravens. Consider, hey, they don't build barns and store food. They just trust that I'm going to feed them. And I do. I take care of them. Quite often, we spend time making sure we are taken care of. Our whole lives, we spend time making sure we are taken care of. It starts when we're a child. And we want Baba, you know, give me the Baba, you know. I just stopped that last month. But, you know, we want what we want. We want it now, you know. And if not, we're going to cry. We're going to whine. I want this now. Some of us don't stop whining. We continue that our whole life. I want this and I want it now. I want it this way. I want everything. And you know what? That's not life. That's not reality. We're not always going to get what we want. But when we trust God, we get what we need. He provides all of our needs. We have to learn the difference between need and want. We have to really identify the things that are important and the things that are necessary. sometimes we make things important that are not really necessary. We don't need to have them. Jesus explains this further in verse 29, where he says, "And do not seek what you should eat or what you should drink, nor have an anxious mind. For all these things the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knows that you need these things, but seek the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added to you." So Jesus said we shouldn't be concerned about our meals, and we shouldn't have an anxious mind. Notice that the world seeks after all of these things, that this is what they want, but they're not really looking for God to provide these things. But as believers, we should be different than the world. We should trust Him with what we need. And God knows what we need before we ask Him for it. It's not like in the morning when I get up, it's like, oh, well, let me wait to hear from Rick what he needs. No, he knows. And he's already taking care of it. A lot of times, I'm not paying attention to how he's taking care of it. Quite often, I perceive what I think I need and how I need to have it prepared. When I have dinner and Cheryl says, "Hey, I'm making this for dinner," I already perceive in my mind what it's going to look like, what it's going to taste like, and I even know what it's going to look like on the plate, and I'm all ready for whatever she has, and I'm salivating just talking about it right now, and it's a blessing to have that knowledge and because we are so close that I kind of know what she's going to do before she does it, and how she does things. I'm used to it now. But with God, a lot of times we have our preconceived notions of what we're expecting to have done, and God doesn't do things our way. He does things just a little bit different. And we're like, oh, I didn't expect that. The worst thing is when God is providing for us and we want something different. We're not happy with what he provides. Oh, children of Israel were terrible about that. He provided for them for 40 years wandering through the wilderness, and they were just terrible about accepting what they got, receiving what they got. Manna. Oh, stinking manna. Not manna again. And they were just, and how come I can't go and collect a bunch of manna to last me all week? I have to go daily and go get the manna. Why can't I, build a storehouse and store up all my manna? No, they had to go daily. Give us this day our daily bread. And God provided it daily. Today's devotion, as a matter of fact, when I was talking about the our daily bread, today's devotion was exactly this topic. Don't look in yours because that's for next month. But this one is for last month, and it was for November. And it shows, let me see here, November 8th. Right? Yeah, Deuteronomy 8:2, and it says, "Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way." And so the devotion is all about the fact that God led the people of Israel, the children of Israel, through the wilderness. And when they got through the wilderness, they were provided meat, they were provided manna, they were provided water. And what did they do every once in a while? They started whining. Oh man, how come we can't have this? How come we can't have this? Man, we should go back to Egypt. They had, the leeks were so good there. Who would mention leeks? Children of Israel would. But I mean, come on. What, the French onion dip was really good? What are they talking about? But that's the attitude that we can get when we stop recognizing the goodness of God and how he provides and meets our needs. They went through the wilderness for 40 years and their clothes didn't wear out for 40 years. Oh, they didn't recognize that as being a blessing. Because, you know, oh, the kids want some new Wranglers and, you know, and here we are with the same old ones and, wow, they magically grow to fit the kids. Isn't that amazing? Remember, they were still having children, you know, so what were they, hand-me-downs? Well, if they were, they were lasting 40 years. Hand-me-downs lasting 40 years with kids. Like, can you believe it? It wasn't like when they turned 30, they were still wearing diapers. God provided for all of their needs. He does the same for us. We just have to recognize those things that he provides for us. Verse 32, do not fear, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell what you have and give alms. Provide yourself money bags which do not grow old, a treasure in the heavens that do not fail, where no thief approaches nor moth destroys, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. See, we shouldn't worry about the things that we don't have because we have an eternal kingdom and God is going to provide for all of what we need for eternity. If we don't trust him for just the years that we're here, how are we going to trust him for eternity? Good preparation for getting us ready for eternity. Since we know that, we can have a light grasp on the things that we have here on earth. We're not taking them with us, and we don't want to, because everything in heaven is going to be much better than here. There's not going to be oxidation in heaven. I just know it. You know, there's not going to be the things that happen here on earth in heaven. Things are going to last. They're going to be beautiful all the time. You're not going to get spots on your water glasses. It's going to be amazing. You know, see, sometimes we think of the little things like that, the frustrating things in life. Oh, I've got to clean the shower walls because the soap scum that's on them and stuff like, you know, but you know what? We're not even going to think about that in heaven. We're not going to have the same kind of trials and tribulations that we go through on earth in heaven. So knowing that, we should be excited about heaven and dwelling on earth in the meantime. We shouldn't be planting deep foundations on the earth. Our foundations on the earth should actually be founded in heaven. It's kind of like I was in the Navy, and we would anchor the ship out sometimes. You wouldn't pull into a port because they didn't have piers that were big enough for a Navy ship. And so you would anchor out. But people think, oh, you drop the anchor and that holds you right there. No, the anchor is actually like over there. And, you know, and the water moves and, you know, the ship is over here, the ship is over here. It isn't just the anchor holding you in one place. It's the chain. You see, you let the anchor out, it hits the ground. And then as you're sitting there, dumping out the chain continues to come out of the ship and it goes on top of the anchor and it goes all around the anchor and it puts weight on the anchor, shoving the anchor into the soil, and then that chain is holding you really in place. And so when the tide comes and you move or you're going up and down with the tide, the chain, you know, goes up and down and it moves around, but that's what's holding you in place. And quite often, you can get quite a ways away. But the thing is, when you start pulling in, you start going back to where the anchor is. When you start pulling, the anchor doesn't drag to you. The ship moves to where the anchor is. You see, our anchor needs to be in heaven. Because that's where we're going back to. That's where we're going to, heaven. We're going there one day. And we're going to stay there. We won't need the anchor anymore. We're going to be there. But the way to get there is to be prepared, is to make sure the anchor isn't loose and starting to drag all over the ocean. We need to be firmly anchored in our hope in heaven. It's something that takes a lifetime to do. You don't do it in one day. Lord, I receive you as my Savior. Thank you for forgiving me. Hey, we become saved. We're Christians now. We're believers. And we're saved. Our sins are cast as far as the east is from the west. They're cast into the lake of forgetfulness, never to be fished out again. We are now saved. Truth. But does that mean that we don't have to do anything else for the rest of our lives? We're not preparing ourselves unless we do something else, unless we grow closer to our Lord, unless we learn more about him. Our human nature tells us, get as much as you can out of this earth. Live as great as you can on this earth. Do the best you can. And that's our human nature. That's, you know, but I believe God gave us that nature also so that we can get the most out of eternity. That we can be prepared more for eternity. Pastor Huck up at Black Canyon City, he did this demonstration, an example of what he always has props and stuff like that. You never know what he's going to bring to the stage, you know? And he would bring props, and he'd take this big, huge rope, and he'd throw it out there across the stage. And he'd say, oh, make believe that goes on forever. And he said, now, this is the beginning of the rope here. And he put a little piece of tape around it. And so from here to here, where the little piece of tape is, he says, that's your life. That's eternity. What are you preparing for? What are you? And he said, the width of the tape, that's your retirement. You know, and it was just a little tiny piece of tape wrapped around, and that's your retirement. So here's your life, here's your retirement, and here is eternity. What are you preparing for? What are you storing up for? And it's true, because God has so much more planned for us. He has so much better plan for us. We just have to have a mindset. That's where we're going. That's what we're looking forward to. We're not looking forward to what's going to happen next week. You know, what's going to happen after this election, after COVID's over, after all that. Who cares? It's going to be the same. How many years have you been here? Hasn't it been the same pretty much? Hasn't changed that much. Oh, yeah, we have a different person to hate. But, I mean, that's all that's really changed. Who we hate, who we love, you know? The music that you listen to, that's changed a little bit over the years. But the fact is that this doesn't matter in the big picture. I was talking with John this morning about creation. And we talked, where did God come from? We're told in the Word of God, he's always existed. So that's where God came from. I can't fathom that. I just don't, you know, where did God come from? All right, so let's just take God out of the picture and just say, there is no God. Where did rocks come from? What, rocks just formed themselves and then banged together and then we had evolution? Which one takes more faith? You know, I can see the hand of God in everything. I can see the love of God in people. I could also see the hatred of the devil in some people too, right? You know, but the fact of the matter is, we are spiritual beings. We don't have to look far to tell that. We even question our own selves sometimes. Where did that thought come from in my mind? You know, how come I'm feeling this? Or how come I'm feeling, we're spiritual beings. But we're still living in the flesh. We have this flesh that we have to contend with. It's a struggle living in the flesh sometimes, right? You know, it really is a struggle. But when we leave this earth, all of the answers are going to be given to us. All of the truths will be revealed to us. We're going to understand better than we ever have before. We're going to know just as we are known. And it's going to be an amazing thing. But we should be prepared for that. Regardless of what's happening here, we should be prepared for what comes next. You know, a lot of times we prepare for events, birthdays and holidays and stuff like that, and we prepare and we get all ready for them and everything. This is how we get prepared for eternity, through the Word of God. We get prepared by reading the Word of God, by feeding on the Word of God, by nourishing ourselves with the Word of God. And then our treasure is stored up more in heaven than it is here on earth. Our concerns about the things on earth diminishes at that time. We just start, you know what? That's not important. This is more important to me. Jesus now gives us details on how we can prepare ourselves for his coming in verse 35. Where he says, let your waist be girded and your lamps burning. First of all, for those of you that don't know what let your waist be girded means, it means be ready for battle, ready for work, ready to go out and do things. They wore robes in those days. And the robes, if you're going to work and you're going to or into battle, you don't want your robe getting in the way. You don't want to trip over your robe while you're working or you're fighting or whatever. You want it to be girded up. And so they would bring it between their legs and tie it up into their belt, and they would gird it up. And that would be preparing them for what they were going to be doing. And then the lamps burning. You need light to work. And keep those lamps burning. And the darker it gets, you want that lamp burning so that you can still see, even in the darkness. Folks, the days are dark. We're living in some dark times. We need to keep the lamps burning. And we turn the lamps on and we keep them burning through the Word of God. Your Word is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. That's what lights us up and keeps us illuminated so that we know where we're going. And you and yourselves be like men who wait for their master when he will return from the wedding, that when he comes and knocks, they may open to him immediately. Weddings in those days, first of all, didn't cost 50 grand. Second of all, they were long. It wasn't like a two-hour event, and it was over. All right, now you're married. Go on your way. Their weddings would take sometimes days, sometimes weeks at a wedding. Can you imagine going to a wedding, even for a few days, you know? Now, we go to weddings, and like if you're going to another city, you go to the wedding, and you may go there and get a hotel early, and then, you know, you have all the prep leading up to the wedding and everything. This is the wedding feast. This is like, I'm going to the wedding, we're going to hang out after the wedding, we're going to have the big celebration, there's going to be all this dancing going on and celebrating, and food! Oh, we're going to have ribeye, and we're going to have, you know, oh, if you can't afford that, we're going to have seagull or something like that. Whatever it is, we're going to celebrate for days and we're just going to have a great time. But you didn't know when it was going to end. It probably when the wine ran out, right? Jesus had a whip up some more wine real quick for one wedding, you know? And the thing is that when it's over, the master now goes home, and his servants are supposed to be ready for him when he gets there. When he knocks at the door, see, they didn't have keys back then. So when they locked the door, it's locked from the inside. So even the master had to come home and he had to knock on his own door to get in. You don't keep the master waiting in his own house when he comes home. You know what I'm saying? So when he knocks, those servants that were ready, that were opening that door right away, they were the ones that were blessed. They were the ones where the Lord, oh, how great that the Lord brought them in and, you know, and started. What did the Lord do at that point? Blessed are those servants whom the master, when he comes, will find watching. Assuredly, I say to you that he will gird himself and have them sit down to eat, and he shall come and serve them. What? The master is going to come and serve the servants. Well, when we look at that as a picture of what's going on in the Christian realm, when our Lord comes back, he's going to come and serve us. Really? How is he going to serve us? Well, have you heard of the wedding that's going to take place up in heaven? We're going to have this big celebration. We're all going to celebrate, and he's going to serve us then. You know, it's not like we have to, it's not going to be like the potluck from last night. We're not going to have to bring the food. He's going to bring it all to us. He's going to bless us. He's going to serve us. And if he should come in the second watch or come in the third watch and find them so, blessed are those servants. The third watch, like we're talking late. If he comes late at night and the servants are ready for him, oh, they're going to be blessed because they're ready when he comes. Yeah, it doesn't really talk much about the ones that aren't ready. Well, we're going to get to that in a minute. But know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. See, Jesus didn't leave this for interpretation. He didn't leave this open for people to make some nice analogy about it. He gives the details here. He said, you, be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you did not expect. Oh, we're not talking about him coming at an hour, at a time of day where, you know, it's not expected that we should expect it. He was talking about coming in the second or the third hour, a watch, okay? And we should expect that he will come at an hour, because when he returns, no man knows the day or the hour of his return, right? No one knows. He's just going to return. So we should be ready at all times, whenever he returns. You know when I think he's going to return? When we think he's not. When we think, oh, everything's okay. People have thought that for quite a while. Everything's okay. He's not coming right now. And we don't have to prepare ourselves for him to come. You know what happened with the Jews? The Jews stopped looking for the Messiah. The Jews just stopped. They didn't look for the Messiah anymore. And now, they're still not looking for the Messiah, really. Oh, they talk about the Messiah, but they're not really looking actively for the Messiah. They're not really pursuing things. They don't even have a temple to hold their sacrifices, so they can't atone for their sin. It's really sad what's going on with them. Oh, don't worry about them. Read Romans chapter 11. You'll find out what's going to happen. But in the meantime, they lost their perspective. They lost their vision for the truth. You see, God has been taking care of them all of their generations, generation after generation after generation. God took care of them. He provided for them in the wilderness. Even when they were taken captive, he provided for them. He released them from their captivity, brought them back into their land. And they took their eyes off of the prize, the Messiah. They took their eyes away just long enough so that they lost sight. We can get the same way. We can be so consumed with the things of the world that our eyesight is taken off of the return of the Messiah, the coming again of our Lord and Savior. He's coming, and it doesn't matter what anyone else tells you. Don't believe me because I'm telling you. Believe me because I'm reading the Word of God, and it tells you. God himself is telling you what's going to happen next. We have the end of the story here. Paul Harvey is up there right now preparing for another speech, you know, with the Lord. He's going to tell us what, you know. No, he's not. He's up there celebrating. We have something to look forward to. And Peter said to him, Lord, do you speak this parable only to us or to all people? Good question. Who is this applying to? Is it just to us? Is it just to the disciples, is basically what he's saying? Or is this to all people? Jesus is going to answer this. And the Lord said, who then is that faithful and wise steward whom his master will make ruler over his household to give them their portion of food in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his master will find so doing when he comes. Truly I say to you that he will make him ruler over all that he has. Wow, good news. The steward is given instructions by the master, take care of my house. Now, this can be applied in two ways, and I'll take it first from the pastor point of view. You see, as a pastor, I'm the steward given the house, this house, to watch over, to take care of the flock, to make sure everything. You guys are still servants. You're servants of the living God, not my servants. You are servants of the living God. We all are. I've been given a role as a steward to oversee the church. And when he returns, I will be blessed if I'm doing what he told me to do when he gave me these instructions. I'm the one that's going to be blessed. So will you. You know why you'll be blessed? Because I was doing what he told me to do the whole time. You see, I was delivering the word of God, the word of truth. It doesn't matter what you believe. If what you believe contradicts the word of God, guess who's wrong? You. I've been wrong many times. Cheryl points that out. And okay, she doesn't really have to do it that often. But there are times when I'm wrong because I read the Word of God and I'm convicted because I know it doesn't matter what I like. It doesn't matter what I think is right. Here's what's right. And I read it in the Word of God, and it's like, I'm wrong. What I've done is wrong. A lot of times, we don't realize what we're doing is wrong up until we're confronted with what we read in the Word of God. And then when we read it, it just comes right out and hits us in the head. The way you're looking at things, the way you're talking to people, the way you're loving people is wrong if you're not doing it the way that God said that we should. A lot of times we do things for our own personal gain. We're nice to certain people, but not nice to other people, you know what I'm saying? Because, oh, those aren't important, but these people are important. They have, you know, big positions and lots of money, and we gotta treat them right. We don't have to treat everyone else right. Jesus died for the wealthy. Oh, I say that as a joke, but He died for everyone. He died for everyone. The thing is that He died for the wealthy too. He died for the poor. He died for the lame. He died for the hopeless. He died for the hurting. He died for the healthy. He died for us all. We shouldn't treat anyone different because He died for us all the same. And everyone has access. When we get to heaven, it's not going to be like, oh, I wish that Billy Graham would get out of the way so I can go up and talk to God. You know, that Billy, he's always taking up God's time and I never get a chance to get up. No, it's not going to be like that. It really isn't. The first will be last and the last will be first. Have you ever dwelt on that? What that means? I have. I still don't know what it means. But I can't wait to find out. I know it means something good. It doesn't mean that we're going to be confused when we get to heaven. Well, it doesn't mean we're going to get a number. Take a number, please. And, you know, oh, I'm sorry, you're number 3,475,000. Please wait in line. No, it means something special, I believe, to us. So let me get back on topic here. But if that servant says in his heart, my master is delaying his coming, and begins to beat the male and female servants and to eat and drink and be drunk, the master of that servant will come on a day when he is not looking for him and an hour when he is not aware and will cut him in two and appoint him his portion with the unbelievers. Ooh, that's painful. So now you have to ask yourself, is that person saved? I thought once saved, always saved. I thought that there wasn't a level of salvation. I thought that, you know, and now we have to question, who are we talking about here? There are many people that know the Word of God, that know the Bible. There are people that come out of high school, and instead of going and getting a degree at a technical college, you know, they go to seminary and they get a degree to become a pastor so that they can lead a church. And that's their desire, that's their goal. And they get all of this knowledge, all of this wisdom, and then they start leading a church. Or they start interpreting the Bible the way that they seem fit to teach. Is it the truth? Who knows? But God knows. You see, and that person may be qualified to lead a church, but that doesn't mean that the Holy Spirit is moving in their heart. It doesn't mean that they've surrendered to the Spirit of God. intellectually, they have the knowledge that it takes to be a pastor, a leader of a church. But spiritually, are they on the same page as the Lord? And here we see that there are some of these stewards that start caring about their own diet. They get drunk, they eat, and they beat the sheep. They beat the servants, male and female, of the master. And that's happening in a lot of churches these days. Not just out in the world, but in churches where there are leaders that are leading the flock astray. If it's not the word of God, if they're adding to it or taking away from it, then they're leading the flock astray. And there, unfortunately, are many churches that do that. I want you guys to be Bereans. I want you guys to study the Word of God on your own. I want you guys to know the Word of God, listen to the Word of God, listen to the Holy Spirit. And if there's something I ever teach that is not in line with what the Word of God says, let me know. So I can go back and correct, you know, what I've said that may be wrong. Now that, I'm not asking you guys to start criticizing everything I teach up here. That's not, what I'm hoping is that you just start reading all of this for yourself and that the Holy Spirit encourages you, teaches you, strengthens what you have already learned. Why do we keep teaching the same thing over and over again? Because we are like the children of Israel in the wilderness. We have everything given to us. We're not satisfied with it, or we forget. We forget that God provided for us all these years. And so we need to hear it again. We need to be encouraged again. We need to be reminded of our relationship with Jesus Christ. Quite often, we forget because we watch the news. There's not much news out there that's in line with the Bible. There's very little news out there that's in line with the Word of God. So instead of trying to find news that's in line with the Word of God, read the Word of God, and then you'll know the news. Because the news about what's going on in the world isn't as important as about what's going on for eternity. Eternity is going to be so much better than what the news has to offer right now. You think so? You know? Because guess what? Our king won, and he's going to be king forever. There's not going to be another election. There's not going to be any legal battle over whether or not he got in there correctly. You know, he's there. He's there forever. Good news. Praise God. And that servant who knew his master's will and did not prepare himself or do according to his will shall be beaten with many stripes. Oof. Beaten with many stripes. This is someone that knew the will of God, knew the word of God even, but didn't follow it, didn't believe it enough to actually act upon it. If you knew that you were going to get hit by a bus, you wouldn't go hanging out in the Greyhound terminal, you know, just seeing what's going on. Oh, well, yeah, I kind of knew I was going to get hit, but, you know, no. You would prepare yourself. Get away from the bus. When you see a bus, you go the other way. But these guys, they knew the will of God, but they didn't follow the will of God. When he did not know, yet committed things deserving of stripes shall be beaten with a few. So those that did not know the truth, okay, This is verse 48. Yet committed things deserving of stripes shall be beaten with a few. This is telling me that there are different levels of punishment in hell. Yes, there's a heaven and there's a hell. And there are different levels of punishment in hell. There are going to be those that didn't know the truth, that didn't hear the truth. And so they're only going to be beaten a little bit because they didn't know the truth. But the ones that knew the truth and didn't do the will of God, knowing what the will of God was, they will be beaten with many. Wow, that's some harsh stuff that we're talking about here. James chapter 3, verse 1. Many of you should not go and become pastors, because if you become a teacher of the word, you're going to be judged harsher than others. Oh, I mean, that was something I had to consider, becoming a pastor. You know, I was just told I was going to be judged harsher because I know the truth. Well, maybe if I didn't read the Bible and I just came up here and told stories, then, you know, that would let me off the hook. No, doesn't let me off the hook. See, the thing is, you guys know too. You know how come I know? Because I teach it. I teach the Word of God. I teach directly from the Bible. And you know what the truth is because you hear it from the Word of God. So you're accountable too. I'm a little more accountable because I'm actually teaching it. But that also tells me there are different levels. There's going to be different punishment levels. You know what I'm happy about? I'm not going to find out. Because I believe in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I've invited the Holy Spirit to live in my life. And I daily look to Him to lead me, to feed me, to nourish me. Give us this day our daily bread. We need it daily. We need to be fed daily so that we're nourished. You know, you can't go to church on Sunday and then, you know, wait the whole week to go back to hearing the Word of God. 6 days without the Word of God makes 1 week. No, 7 days without the Word of God makes 1 week. 1 week? Week. Never mind. Okay, so anyway, let's just jump back in here. For everyone to whom much is given, from him much will be required, and to whom much has been committed, of him they will ask more. In closing, I want to encourage you, don't worry, be ready. Be ready, because he told us he's coming back. We know. He said, therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. Be ready, because it's any hour. And I believe that's the time that we're living in right now. Peter tells us in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 3, knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last days and walk according to their own lusts. People are doing what they want to do. Well, I feel this. I feel this, so I'm going to do what I feel is right. And it must be from God because I feel it. Oof. Oof. You know, we can't go on feelings. We can't base our happiness on feelings. And we can't base truth on feelings. We have to base it all on the Word of God. He speaks the truth. He lets us know what's right and what's wrong. And we don't have a choice saying, I'm going to believe this truth, but I'm not going to believe this truth. We don't have a choice. We either believe all the truth, or we might as well just live for the lie. And the lie's out there. That's what we watch in the news. That's what we watch on TV and all the different shows that tell us that we can have happiness and hope. We can get self-help books, and we can follow other humans that tell us the right way to do things, the way we should live, and how we can have happiness. There's only one truth, and that's the truth that Jesus Christ gave us. Happiness is found in knowing the truth, even if we don't like it. We can find peace and happiness in knowing the truth. And we just have to submit to that truth. We're seeing it right now in the church. We're seeing churches that are going after this false teaching, allowing anything to come in just so that they can build up their numbers and build up their finances. And Philippians 2:10 says that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, of those in heaven and those on earth and those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Everyone is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I want to confess that because he is my Lord, not because he wasn't my Lord. But I have to confess it because he is the Lord, because it's the truth. I want to do it because it's the truth for me. And I want that for you too, for all of you, for each of you, to confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. We shouldn't fear the day of his return. Instead, we should look forward to it and encourage each other in it, because he is coming very soon. Amen?